Welcome to Italian Innovators. I'm Luca Cottini, and today I'm in the company of Paolo Ciuccarelli, architect, communication designer, professor of design at Northeastern, and for many years at Politecnico di Milano, and founder of the Density Design Research Lab, an award-winning laboratory for data visualization and information design. Paolo's work revolves around design transformations that allow easy understanding of complex data and improve decision-making processes. His research also includes the study on the impact of rhetoric and visual poetry on communication design and the investigation on meta design. And we'll discuss these topics at length in our conversation. For the moment, thank you very much, Paolo, for accepting my invitation to be in the show.
Thank you, Luca, for having me. Really glad to be here and discuss all the topics that we know we will discuss.
So today we'll explore the Italian cultural model as an archetype of design thinking. We'll consider the links between cultural imagination and architecture, the role of rhetoric in the understanding of data, and the impact of design and meta-design in the visualization of complexity. I want to start from your story, though. How did you become a professor, and how did your Italian education help you craft your professional path?
Of course, it has been a long journey, and but in a way, also kind of straightforward, meaning that I studied at Politecnico di Milano. I studied architecture. That's my background. And I, when I finished, I was a little bit puzzled, you know, as anybody, you know, what to do in the next life, you know, after university. But at that point, something happened. You know, I think my path, my journey is like a sum of, you know, things that happened, you know, events that not planned, most of them, but that can, you know, if you can grasp them, that may change your career. So at that time, something was happening at Politecnico, so that a couple of professors were working on the idea of building a design school that didn't exist. That's kind of, you know, may sound strange, you know, with such an heritage and a tradition, and Italy is well known for design, but there was no design education at that time at university level. So that was the idea, and I was lucky, I would say, to be part of that group that were thinking about this idea. And then after a couple of years of collaboration, then I started. That was really, I decided it was really worth to join that adventure. It has been an adventure. You know, the beginning was really, really a strong kind of battle. But at the end, you know, nowadays, Design Politecnico di Milano is one of the biggest schools, I think, in the world in terms of numbers, but also very well positioned. It's number 5 in the world, number 6, whatever, being a public school. That's the way I entered into the academic field in the middle of that battle to find a space for design education at university at that time. And then after that was kind of a rush, you know, to fill that space, and I moved into different branches of design as it became available. So product design at the beginning, as usual, that's where you start, and then communication design as soon as this became available, and then eventually information design, that is actually what I claim to be my field now. And that's the field I'm also working on at Northeastern University, where I moved in 2019. Yeah, that's kind of short version, but it was thanks to that challenge that I decided to embrace, because I could see really there was a gap to be filled.
Well, thank you. And this also sheds light on the Italian education with which, for what regards like design, we are used to thinking, as you were saying, of Italy as the homeland of design, but there is a structure in Italy that is related to the workshop system, so not like an academic institution for design. And it's quite interesting that this came about only fairly recently, in the late 90s. So design is part of Italian culture, but it became part of the Italian academic culture only fairly recently. Now, Italian culture instead can be really defined as a relational, human-centered, and experiential model of knowledge. And these are all qualities that we commonly associate to design thinking. Now, in your opinion, in which way Italian culture embodies a model of design thinking? And can you make some example of this?
I don't know if I'm allowed, but I wanted to get back to the first question.
Yes, absolutely.
I complete my answer in a way, because I didn't answer to the second part of the question that was about how my Italian culture, you know, my education in a way helped me embrace that challenge and become part of the academic system. Well, first of all, I think what helped me a lot is that, you know, when I started to think about design and to work in the design field, I had a background in architecture. So, and I'm really glad now, more than I was at the beginning when I made that choice, that I choose to study architecture, because, and I can say that now that I'm here at the Center for Design, where I'm kind of going back to that roots, I think this kind of background, architecture, so this sense of space, sense of context, and it really helped me a lot in finding my way through design. And I think it's helping now a lot finding a position for design in the realm of data. So I'm really glad that I had made this choice of learning architecture that I would say is broader in a way than design, but in a very good sense, and then help you, you know, defining design problems and data problems in a richer way. You know, and that's where I learned, for example, about complexities through my study in architecture. I'm not sure I would have the same learnings, you know, from a design school. So yeah, that was for completing my answer about my path, my journey, and my education. Design thinking is really kind of a controversial topic in a good sense again. So I'm happy that at a certain point, you know, people from the design, the business community especially, came up with this idea of design thinking. And it helped, I think, a lot design to establish within the business domain, you know, within the industries. But it was a kind of a shortcut that worked, you know, to give design a certain space. Is it reductive as a shortcut? It is, you know, as all the shortcuts. It's a kind of a reductive vision on design, but that helps a lot in the dialogue with other disciplines and business especially. So I'm happy that that happened, this phenomenon. And because for us, you know, as a designer, you always think design, you think as a designer. So design thinking is what we are. The fact that someone realized that there was a good way of thinking, a useful way of thinking, and that tried to package it in a way that could be understood and practiced even in other contexts, in other domains, sometimes without designers involved, in a way, I think that was a good thing and helped us connecting with other domains, with other disciplines, with other contexts that we may not have been able to connect in other ways. How this can be framed within the Italian culture, I mean, my understanding of that is that it's all about the relationship between science and humanities. And that's, I think, also what I'm thankful is the way design has been established at Politecnico di Milano. So it's just exactly in between, you know, the scientific realm of engineering and this kind of humanistic approach that I got personally from architecture. So there was a lot of humanistic thinking, I think, in the courses that I had at Politecnico in architecture. So design was a kind of a bridge between these two realms. And I think that's a very good way to interpret design, as a kind of a bridge, junction, or interface between opportunities that often come from technology development and needs of humanity in a society and human beings that you can understand if you have a kind of a humanistic background much better. So this, considering design as this kind of bridge, I think it's, I would say, the essence of design, and that has been helping people to translate that into a formula like design thinking in the best possible way, be reductive, but in a way that it's not too much and connects with their needs. I think that's our mission. So I love to talk with people that are doing design thinking, to do things together, and trying to bring that idea that it's, you know, it's something that helped as a bridge, as a connection, as a reduction, as a shortcut, but it needs to be a little bit enriched in order to really resemble the way design thing. And what is one pillar, if I may add, is that it's very important in that dialogue between people practicing design thinking in other contexts and designers, I think, is practice. So we think by doing, we think through practice. And sometimes this is lacking in design thinking frameworks. There is a lot of talking, a lot of writing, a lot of discussion, but there is no artifact involved. And so there is no making, no doing. And that's, I think, is essential to have a real, you know, rich interpretation of design and to translate that into a design thinking formula that works.
Absolutely. And this is like the art of making. There are two words in Greek for making. One is prasso, so the practice of making. The other one is poiein, from which poetry, fusion of meaning to an object that you are making, that you are creating. So in the sense, design thinking has this intermediate space between technology or the practical world and the humanity as kind of the creation of meaning. In the sense, I go back to what you were saying about architecture at the beginning, because really the paradigm of humanism, 15th and 16th century, was the book by Vitruvius on architecture, and the Roman architect who theorized architecture as the sum of all the arts, as the space where all the arts find their meaning. And of course, another great design thinker of the Renaissance is Leon Battista Alberti, who really devised the idea of perspective, not just as a technical development, but really as a way of thinking about ourselves in space. So in this sense, I really like the connection between this mental space that architecture generates and the space of imagination. And as I discussed in another episode, really, Italian buildings, in a way, are projections of books or of imaginations, especially starting from the Renaissance. And books are really, in a way, complex mental architectures as well. Now, architecture, we said, is an external projection of an inner world. But how do you design, if we relate to communication, a communication that taps both into the inner imagination of a product and its external facade or architecture? Then what is, since you mentioned it before, what is communication design for you?
Well, again, I want to add something to the previous point, because, you know, well, it's really a kind of a conversation. So yes. Anything you say that resonates, and then I wanted to add something. So looking back at my journey, I think at the end, it makes perfectly sense that I joined on a certain point, Northeastern University, where there is a driving idea, the driving concept that is humanics. And humanics means, you know, in the words of our president at Northeastern University, really this kind of humanistic interpretation of technology and opportunities that comes from innovation that are usually, you know, especially in the United States, the core of research universities. But if you don't have this capacity, these competencies, these skills as design, for example, to connect this innovation that is really incredible here, you know, the pace, the scale of innovation in terms of technology is huge, but you have to have this combination of science and humanities that here it's called humanics. And I think the fact that all the university with all the disciplines is driven by that concept is, you know, I feel at home, you know, in a way, given my roots. So communication design, you know, funny enough, doesn't exist here. For example, I was discussing this yesterday with the people working in comm studies, communication studies. But to me, I would say it's pretty simple in a way. So any interface that you design to mediate a communication process, that's communication design. So whether it's a book, is a website, is an app, is a banner, is a wayfinding systems, you know, it's all these dialogues, these exchanges of information need interfaces. And these interfaces are designed by communication designers that have to be aware of what communication means and what is the essence of communication, how communication works socially, you know, as human beings, and to transfer that into the design of interfaces that mediate. And it's now more relevant than ever, if you think about how social media, mm-hmm. how media in general are shaping our agenda, our lives. I mean, that's where communication design should intervene. And I may even say that there is no product that is not also a kind of a communication interface. So even when you design a product, a very high-tech functional product, there is a kind of a meaning attached to that. There is a kind of a cultural level that needs to be designed, and that's where communication designers may help. So even if you work on product design, or I think having a communication designer on board may help, because no product, I think nowadays, is just a product of just, you know, a tool or enabling an action, or it's something more than that usually. Even if it's a B2B product, there is some kind of meaning attached, and that's where communication design can help. That would be my definition of communication design.
And there is a semiotics of the object that is always involved in designing it, even designing a handle, because you're suggesting a way to use that object. So there's always a communication.
That's something I'm really happy about, is that, you know, in my career in the last, I would say probably 10, 15 years, I worked on this course that I had at Politecnico di Milano. It was a studio-based course. The semiotics was on board, I think, since the beginning. So it was about data, information design, data visualization. But semiotics has been part of that, I think, since the beginning. Because, again, if data is just yet another material that has to be shaped and make sense, if it makes sense in that context, as a matter of, again, communication is science, is signage, is something that signals something. It's part again of a communication product, and that is not an accident. It was stemmed out of the communication design program, this idea of working with data visualization and information design, because data is just yet another way to create meaning and to spread it. And how can you do that without semiotics involved?
Absolutely. And really, the work on the production of an object is contemporary to the work of the production of its meaning. So in this sense, it is truly important what you are stressing about the relationship between the humanities and technology, the engineering, the design aspect, in the fact that the attention to the object is the attention to create something that is important. Word importare in Latin means to matter. So to create objects that are functional, but also matter something, they say something. Now, in this sense, I wanna ask you something about the connection you establish between kind of visual poetry and rhetoric and big data. So you see them as key languages to improve and make sense of big data. I want to ask you why, and more broadly, I want to ask you, what is the impact of the humanities on data visualization, on content creation, and the design of what you call really the narrative interfaces that you were referring to before?
I would say that probably, I don't know, 5, 10 years ago, let's say 10 years ago, there was no space for these kinds of conversations in the data visualization domain. So data visualization started as a scientific problem. So how to visualize data in a way that makes, you know, analytic processes more efficient. So it's all about analysis. And up to a certain moment, you know, it was clear. I mean, nobody was questioning the way this data should be visualized. So there was a very clear understanding and a very clear idea about the way. And that way was profoundly, you know, rooted into the scientific language. But it was so obvious and kind of embedded into the practice that nobody was questioning that. So that there was even no awareness of that kind of roots. So meaning that scientific language in itself is a rhetoric. So it's a rhetorical, it speaks about a way of looking at the world. It speaks about precision. It speaks about accuracy. It speaks about things that we learn when we learn math and science and algebra and geometry at school. So it's all, you know, intrinsically, I don't know, it's Cartesian. It's all that kind of way of thinking. It's reduction, is that kind of method, is the scientific method that is translated into a language that perfectly resembles that method. But nobody was thinking to that, I think, to a certain point, because that was so clear, so obvious. That's where I see also the connections with complexity. So what complexity is a conversation that started with cybernetics and a group of interdisciplinary intellectuals that gathered around, after the Second World War, I think around that period, and they started to discuss the evident, crisis of a certain way of thinking to problems and trying to resolve them. And so this crisis of let's say the modern scientific method and is, I think, what produced also in a way a crisis in a positive sense, crisis may be positive, a crisis in the way of looking at languages that we use to represent data. So there was a similar crisis many years later that brought, I think, opened a door for a humanistic interpretation of that activity of translating data into something that could be understood, analyzed. But that's something that really came again recently into the scene. And nowadays it's part of every data visualization conference. There is always a track about storytelling with data and narrative data. You have practitioners involved, you have even artists that are, speaking at those kinds of very scientific conferences. That space has been opened recently. And I could claim that part of this door, this process of opening that door, there is a role that the lab that I founded at Politecnico di Milano played, in my opinion. So the way that we started shaping information designers, so educating information designers, and we transferred that into the education of designers working with data. Some of them became actors of this door opening in the field of science with new ways of designing with data that bring this humanistic elements into the field. So ideas like going back to sketching with data, or like representing data by hand, not through computers, that inevitably generate visualizations that embed this kind of rhetoric of science, but starting to bring some kind of human touch in the way data are visualized. That's something that I think the lab, Density Design Lab, contributed to, and that happened in a moment that when there was a crisis contributed to open that door. But that's something that is really a process, and it happened in the last 10 years, I would say, but it's now very evident. Also because many other factors contributed, the fact that we have big data, you mentioned big data. I think if we didn't have big data with their features like, veracity, the problem of uncertainty, ambiguity, all these kind of peculiar aspects of big data, they contributed to that crisis. They were not the data that we were used to have before. No. New data, algorithms. If it wasn't for algorithms, we didn't probably have those conversations that we're having today around biases. Biases means that there is nothing is really true. I mean, there are always these human components. Biases are human, uncertainty is human. So the more we have data and algorithms that approximate the complexity of the inherent complexity of social phenomena or natural phenomena, the more we have these elements like ambiguity, uncertainty, whatever, that we need to address with different languages, because it's the opposite. It's not precision and accuracy that we have in the scientific language or the traditional scientific language. It's different. It's are different features that you need to visualize in different ways.
I'm glad that you pointed to the double nature of design as both planning and, in the Italian sense, in its relation to drawing, design as disegno. So the sketching, something, the human aspect that allows the communication of big data. And this also taps into the relationship between complexity and the design of complexity in a simple form. I think of all the growth of, for example, infographics on newspapers over the last 10 years, and especially during the pandemic, the design of big data in a simple form in the communication of a big amount of data in a simple form. So design is, or the drawing act as a form to visualize complexity in a digestible form in a simple way. Now, I also want to ask you if you want to comment on the relationship between complexity and simplicity, if you want to add something, but also if you can say something on the impact of meta design and what is meta design on the innovation process, and how does meta design help designers to also overcome the biases that you were describing?
I would separate these two questions. First of all, I mean, they both deserve kind of their own space. So first of all, complexity and simplicity, I mean, that's really the struggle. I mean, it's that relationship, and it's a trade-off. It's, you know, we know, and that's now, I think, more evident than ever, that all the social and natural phenomena we have to deal with, especially the difficult ones, they are complex by nature. So that's a fact. It's not, there is no question, I think, that all the major problems we are facing and trying to address, they are complex. Simplicity is kind of a need, I think. It's something that helps us trying to address those issues and try to orient those issues to the extent that it's possible, being them complex, to a desired outcome or direction. So we are trying to orient those complex phenomena, and we need to, in order to do that, to be efficient in doing that and effective, we have to reduce. But my mission has been to reduce as less as possible, because the more you reduce, the more you lose aspects and elements of and features and nuances of that phenomenon that may be essential for making an effective decision. So what I'm interested in supporting people to make good decisions, but being aware of the complexity and the richness of the phenomena they are addressing. So for me, it's always a struggle. It's always a kind of a frustration in some sense, because you know that you're losing something by reducing and by aiming at a certain level of simplicity, but you know that you need it, because otherwise people will not be able to understand. But doing that in the right way, so with the right amount of complexity, that is not too much, but it's not too low in terms that you lose too much of the. That's really the core of the design activity of that. So knowing the opportunity of technologies, knowing the humanity that is part of that, and trying to come up with a good balance between complexity and simplicity, then make that problem understandable and manageable. So that's what we aim to, and it's a constant dialogue. It's a negotiation.
This is also in a work of art, the negotiation between saying too much and saying too little, and also in an orchestra, like the temporary balance of the complexity.
Yeah, it's especially difficult with the public, so to say. I mean, I always think about public as a plural, so that there is no public, you know. With the public, you know that, you know, people are less and less paying attention to things, that kind of reluctant to read and to go through data. And so with those kinds of users, it's really complicated. You have to get their attention, you have to guide them through the data, and then maybe eventually they will be able to get something out of the data. But it's really, really difficult. So to me, that's the most difficult challenge we have, not to, you know, to present data to experts, because there are many, many ways, and there is background knowledge that you can leverage on. But with the public, with newspapers, with public engagement, with data and information, scientific facts, that's really difficult. And the pandemic, I think, was a very good lesson. I think there is no other way at a moment in history when we had so many data about something on a global scale with a decent level of methodology behind. And we had we used all the possible means to represent those data and all the possible media but yet people behaved in unexpected, unpredictable, and unwanted ways, and with all this effort. So that is something that is not still working on that idea of public engagement with scientific facts, with data, especially with the public, with the masses, with people outside that we, and that's ultimately what we want to do, to have an impact by directing the behavior of people in a way that is socially, of course, relevant. We are going there, that's the direction, but it's not yet, we are not yet there. But that's why we are researching. And meta design, again, yeah, that's also very interesting, because I'm now working a lot on meta design, and something that I started with. So my first course at Politecnico di Milano was a laboratorio called Meta Progetto, Meta Design. And I'm now going back to that because I think it's a very, very relevant and timely concept nowadays. So first of all, I claim that it started in Italy. I mean, according to the research I've done, you know, the first person that came with this term, meta design, meta progetto, was in Italy. Well, it wasn't Italian, it was Dutch designer, but he wrote on an Italian magazine, architecture magazine, about meta design. And that was around, you know, the 60s, there is a connection with cybernetics and complexity. So that's why I like that concept of meta design. But now, I mean, we need that more than ever, you know, with the, especially, for example, if we think to big data algorithms, that's something that will impact design as all the other fields. So there is no doubt that design will change, because AI will enter into the field, will help creativity unfold in different ways. But then the question is, who is designing the algorithms that design the new things? So if it's true, and to a certain extent is true, that we will not be replaced, of course, by algorithms, but we will design with algorithms, who designs the algorithms for the designers? So this is a form of meta design that I think is pretty relevant. We will have certainly generative design, meaning that some products, some services, some interfaces will be generated by, even directly by algorithms, something that is already happening. But who is determining this space of opportunities, this metrics of potential changes that then happens in a way that is not directly controlled by the designer? Who designs that design process? That's, I think, a very relevant interpretation of design. So it's design that works on a different level, designing the rules of design and not designing a solution. But it's again something that brings back to the origin of a period of architecture. So I have a book wrote by Magnaghi, was a professor in architecture, that wrote a book about architecture in school, and it's a book of diagrams. There is no picture of a building. He defined there is meta project in the title, and it defines the way, the rules for those spaces, educational spaces, to work. And then he says, you know, I designed that diagram, I designed those rules, and then there will be designers, architects, that will interpreting those rules in different contexts, in different moments, but all reflecting that meta design project. So it's designing on a different level. Has to do with diagrams, has to do with conceptual design, with putting some, you know, knowledge together and creating a space of opportunity that has to be interpreted by designers. But it's also something that's happening on identities. So what is the identity of a brand nowadays? It's dynamic, it's constructed by different contributions, but it's always orchestrating all of that. That's, I think, meta design. There is a lot of Italian history in that. So again, his book, Vanonk, and the article on meta design, and Mendini with Alessi, you know, when Alessi wanted to change is entirely, you know, the production, he saw that there was a kind of a crisis in that space. He called Mendini, and Mendini did a meta progetto. So he defined the whole idea of the production of that company by introducing new materials and introducing especially new vision on products. Forms follow fiction, not function. That was a new perspective. And then it just designed that, not just, but designed that overarching idea. And then that idea has been interpreted so far, you know, up to now, by many different designers in many different ways. that's something that you can easily see through the catalog of an essay. This is the kind of meta design that I like and that I'm trying now to apply in the field of data. One of the most interesting projects we are doing here is about design and AI and how design is impacting the design process. And I think that's something that really reflects the idea, this idea of meta design.
Because you were speaking about the story of meta design in the 1960s, 1970s in connection to cybernetics, I had in mind like the same developments in literature, for example, in a figure like Calvino, who actually theorized the idea of meta literature. He was the one who really theorized the concept of stories that are made by themselves. Which is now developing like with AI. But like at the time of Calvino, he wanted to create a frame or a framework, for example, in the Castle of Cross Destiny, Castello dei Destini in Crociati, or the Invisible Cities, Le Città Invisibili, where the design of the frame was the design of the story. So in a way, the whole attention was the design of the structure that allows a story to happen. So it's quite interesting that these developments appear in the material world and in the intellectual imagination at the same time as a reflection on what moves, what is the frame behind an object or behind a communication or behind a book, a mental architecture. Of course, this has an impact on the creation of stories. There are numerous apps that promote and sell kind of self-producing stories. Now, what we discussed so far really positioned us in a space that is very familiar to me with Italian innovators, but also to you, I'm sure, which is in between academia and entrepreneurship. So it's a space where academic knowledge and entrepreneurial knowledge, so the knowledge in the making, constantly interact with each other. So for example, in the structure of a lab or in the structure of this YouTube platform. So how would you describe the approach to innovation of an academic vis-a-vis the entrepreneur? And what are the elements of similarity, difference, and mutual help?
I can speak for design, and in design, that's essential. So I think you can't be a good academic person if you have no idea on how the entrepreneurial work is performed outside. So I'm pretty much in favor of having this kind of double relationship with, you know, because it has to be reciprocal. So you have to be able to practice both worlds and to transfer knowledge on both directions. And that's something that I'm really appreciating here. So this is not only accepted here in the United States, in Northeast, and well, that's what I know, but it's encouraged and it's supported. So you can, of course, have another activity outside, a company or something that you run outside, and bring that into the university. But, you know, transparently, it's something that you bring as an additional contribution. It's not something that is, and sometimes you have universities communicating about activities that professors have performed in that other realm as with their own entrepreneurial skills, I would say. So this, I think that's a fertile dialogue, because, you know, the presumption is that anybody's working on that connections for the good, for transferring the knowledge that is needed, because designers will eventually go in that space, go in that world, and you have to know how it works, and then prepare them for that, because that will be that space. So if you don't know how it works, how can you prepare them for facing that? And so that's something I like. So in brief, in a short, it's essential and has to be structurally and efficiently, because I, you know, it's difficult, embedded into the academic world. But that's something that's also reflected by conferences. I mean, practitioners in design conferences was maybe obvious, but now we have also scientific conferences that are opening more and more spaces. And that's especially true for data visualization for practitioners. So you have practitioner entire tracks of conferences led and attended by practitioners. You have workshops led by practitioners. You have artists, as I said, playing in that field. So that's something that is more happening. And for design, you know, design research is all about practice and research, and researching by practice. We say that we research through design. So we design, and by doing design, we advance our research. It's essential, has to be systematically and correctly and transparently embedded into the academic world.
And also really entrepreneurship as a mindset, really as a posture that can be summarized by the Italian word impresa, which means both company and adventure, adventurous feet. Like and in a way, any academic as every entrepreneur in doing research is doing the impresa. So he's stepping into an uncharted territory and making something of it and gaining new knowledge.
Yeah, but you can be, you're right. You can be entrepreneurial within the academic context, and that's something that I did, you know, and I'm doing here. So I created density design at Politecnico di Milano, and I'm happy that it now is still working as an independent entity. So I'm not that at the moment. And here I'm creating this center for design that you see here. That's another, but it's different. So I can say I'm a kind of an entrepreneur in the academic domain, but being an entrepreneur outside is not the same. So you have to learn something else. And I'm trying to learn also those kinds of competencies that it's not easy, it's not the same, it's an adventure.
Absolutely. So thank you very much for this really enlightening conversation. We just tapped into the surface of many, many problems, but I hope this will be an invitation for many to investigate more on the topics that we discussed. So we examined the Italian culture as a model of design thinking. We examine design as a language of complexity and simplicity, communication as a tool to promote solid decision-making and grounded innovation, and entrepreneurship as a space of constant research and experimentation, and also strategy and creativity, if you want. So thank you very much for all your work at your lab and all your time and the conversation of today.
Thank you again, Luca, for having me here. I'm always happy to discuss those topics.
Thanks for watching. And if you like this presentation, this interview, I invite you to subscribe to this channel or to the newsletter on the webpage of the show at www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes and know more about this project. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for updates, news, and additional materials. Thanks again for your support. Arrivederci e alla prossima!